Parliament. Welcome to the Athenaeum, the Marian Minor Cook Athenaeum. I am not an Arts Fellow, and it's Arts Fellows who usually introduce these programs. I am Nita Kumar, a professor in the History Department at Claremont McKenna College. But it's my great pleasure, because of their absence for various reasons, illness and so on, to be the one to welcome you here today. And then I would have taken over anyway, because I'm going to introduce a very different kind of program. Instead of a lecture or even a music program, we have something which is a sort of final project. Not final, final, they still have a paper. Of one class mainly, History 154, called The Makers of India and Pakistan, : Gandhi, Jinnah and Nehru. And two other classes that are also participating, Introduction to South Asia and Everyday Life in South Asia. So, first of all, I would really like to give a really hearty round of applause for the students who are doing this. It was because of a very perspicacious move by the Dean of Faculty's office at Claremont McKenna College that certain Mellon grants were offered to bring visitors to work with one's classes at CMC, and I brought a theatre director, Gaurav Saini, who you'll hear from after the scenes are over today. He worked with my classes, and with the main one, The Makers of India and Pakistan, we had a weekly session of about an hour in which he did physical work and taught them, you know, various strategies by which they could enact and use through movement and embodiment the things that they were learning in their usual round of readings and discussions in the class. So the first thing I want to say is that thanks to the Mellon grant, thanks to the Dean of Faculty's office, I was able to do something which I have tried a little bit in the past, never very, very well and seriously, and also that I believe in, which is that there are many ways of learning, but the best ways of learning sometimes still elude us if we still keep to the well-known, familiar, comfortable ways. I believe a lot in performance in all the arts, and this is just one example. So that's one thing. But the second thing is that with their work in this physical and embodied way, I think they'll be able to show you something interesting about the making of India and Pakistan, about South Asia. And so I don't want to linger at all, I want to turn it over to them. But just remember, it's not a theatre class, it's not a theatre performance, which is all not bad news, but very good news. It's just that we have worked on it selectively between all the many, many tasks that students have to do in their classes anyway. So welcome, and thank you so much.
By telling you a story. 400 years ago, the Mughal Shahs believed beloved wife died in childbirth. He went into grieving for a whole year, and when he emerged, his hair had turned white. To honor her, he built a mausoleum over the course of 22 years. And to ensure that there would never again be a building like the Taj Mahal, he ordered that the right hand of each worker and architect be destroyed. Some of you may say that this is a fanciful tale, but I am honored to present to you today proof of this story. This is, as you can see, the finger crusher that was used on the hands of not only of the chief architect, but also of some 3,000 workers. It was in the possession of the Mughal Shahs for many years before it disappeared mysteriously during the 18th century to resurface at the Tower of London. As you can see, from the stains, this has seen some recent usage, and history being a process not only of witnessing but participation, I invite you all afterwards to come examine this closely, perhaps even try it out, sir, if you would volunteer. Thank you.
What is history? History is detective work. You search for data, and you find it. The best historians are those who aren't the best detectives. History is interpretation. It is the science of hermeneutics. The best historians are those who can put two and two together and come up with five. Debate, a never-ending debate, with which we move on to today's topic. Let's look at India, our modern-day India, to get into our current framework.
Wait, wait, would you mind to give me a favor?
Sue, yeah. So, what is this?
It's a drum. I make drums for them.
Oh, how do you make them?
Cowboy.
Okay. Oh, so, well, how is your business going?
It's going very well. I receive orders from everywhere around here. I wouldn't mind opening a shop in Bombay or Delhi or maybe even America.
America? How are you going to do that?
Internet. My son showed me how to use it. He's a very clever boy, as of all my children.
Oh, yeah.
He goes to BPS.
BPS? What is it?
It's a very expensive school. I pay for all of my children.
That's good. What is your name?
Dalton Vishwakarma.
Dalton Vishwakarma.
Okay.
So, how are you?
How are things? When will I
interview you? Soon.
Thank you.
Things are good. Family's good. Work is good. Life is good.
These towns absolutely gone down to dogs. Look at these people, lower caste, doing nothing, still getting on the money. Look at us Brahmins, well respected in society back then. Now no money. Stupid people.
Sorry for that. Well, now I'm a famous politician, sir. I'm Rabbi Al Sharma, and I'm actually, unlike this Brahmin brother, I'm actually doing very good in my business.
What is your business?
Well, my business is I sell shoes, but it's very unrespectable in my caste, but I don't care. It's bringing me a lot of money, and my family and children are very well fed, and I'm very happy with some politicians. Namaste.
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 How are you? How are things? Is it good?
I'm good.
Everything's good?
Everything's good. So what is your name?
I'm pretty excited about that.
What do you do here?
So my father started this business 10 years ago and I took over something. And I have three sons, no, two sons, one went and became an artist. But two sons who helped me out. And yeah.
How's work going?
Some days good, some days not so good. Now festival season's about and so too much business I get. But otherwise it's okay.
So Mr. Politician, I would like to ask you something. How do you see India changing?
India changing. Country.
Very good.
Don't you take on the same halakhi. Like a saw, it cuts when it goes, and it cuts.
SubhanAllah! SubhanAllah!
Your Majesty, would you do us the honor of granting us entry into your court? Shahenshah, may we have you into your court?
Your rhymes are sweet and your hearts are pure. However, I have more pressing issues to deal with today. Come back, my mind is clear. Bring more verse and we will discuss your fate then. Atlea. Abu Fazil.
Shahenshah.
Bring in Ram Hassan.
Maharaj Rana Prasad.
Shahenshah, it's great to see you.
Rana Prasad, it's great to see you again too. Brings you here today.
My army is amidst battling the Marathas in the deep south. Our forces are very depleted. I come to request that your army join with mine. I come bearing gifts to Lidzi.
Rubies from Iran.
Rubies from Iran.
Sword from Tibet.
The sword from Tibet.
Sword from Tibet.
Mother of Pearl from Ethiopia.
Mother of Pearl from Ethiopia.
Mother of Pearl from Ethiopia. Your gifts and gratitude please me. As a token of my pleasure, you give this robe. And with it, the promise that we will extend the empire of Hindustan together.
Allahu Akbar! Allahu Akbar! Allahu Akbar!
Today's
today's debate on British rule in India. Today is a special occasion, for we have with us two experts on the topic. Please help me welcome Professor Anise of the University of Oxford, who will be supporting British interests, as well as Professor Indiraja of the University of Mumbai, who will be supporting Indian interests. Professor Anise, please give your opinion.
When the British gained rule in India, they began to modernize the country. For example, they installed a railroad through the country, which provided easy and fast transportation between locations that previously would have taken days or weeks to reach. The ease of this travel made the railroads popular, and people from all over India, all different castes and religions, were brought together on train cars. Here we can see the scene of one of the train cars where people from all over the country find themselves traveling to a common destination.
Nonsense. He sits inside and we have to stand outside here like animals?
It's the English compartment, you can't go inside.
No, I'm going in.
Stop. Yes?
Why do you get to sit inside and we have to hang outside?
This is first class. Go back to your third class if you want me to call the guards. Out!
I would you not to go inside?
British occupy the trains and use it to transport their commercial goods and soldiers around India. Indians are relegated to precariously hanging out from the roof while watching their natural wealth being transported to the metropole. Therefore, the building of public infrastructure, like the railways, was not a sign of the British desire to modernize India. Rather, it was a means to exploiting India.
The British also brought beneficial reforms to the country. For example, the abolishment of the tradition of sati. Long called for from reformers such as Ramon Hood, who we just saw, it was not until the British rule and pressure that the practice was officially abolished.
Ladies and gentlemen, sati took place very rarely and only in certain communities and places. Akbar had already banned it. The British blew this out of proportion just to show how barbaric the Indians were. The British were not interested in giving back to Indian society and developing Indian life. In this scene, you will witness the plight of poor peasants who, in a case of serious drought, have to walk 1,000 miles to meet their absentee landlords.
Saiti! Oh, Saiti, help us, Saiti, please! Saiti, help!
Who are you again?
Saiti, come and sing! My family is farmed on land for 6 generations, Saiti, please, help us!
What are you doing here? Go back to your work.
Saiti, there's been a drought for 2 years. There's no food, no water, nothing. We've lost 3 kids. Look at my wife. She's dying. Saiti, we won't make the tax, please.
Okay, enough of your excuses. Go back to work. You need to pay your taxes. Take them away.
Saiti?
Thank you.
Saiti?
Once again, ladies and gentlemen, as you can see, the British were not interested in the welfare. The British were not giving back and developing industrial life because all the money was being transported back to London.
Finally, the British installed new schools at top of British curriculum in English. The English-speaking curriculum was especially important because it then allowed Indian students to either study in London schools, such as Gandhi, Jinnah, and Nehru all did, or at least allowed them access to Western science and philosophy textbooks in English. Essentially, English education in Indian schools meant for the British to lead up the entire Western world, Western scholarship and aptitude.
Indian citizens. There's no focus on vernacular languages or emotive aspects of Indian history and culture. The main reason British formal education was to train a professional civil class of people that were just mindlessly listen to British orders. Even if we were to recognize that a British Western education had some value in its modern context, look at the way they conducted the lessons. It was clearly boring and it's not encouraging critical thinking. Therefore, British formal education was useful to create an industrial working class of people that would serve Britishness and not to further the intellectual horizon of Indian people. Therefore, we once again argue the British rule was detrimental to India.
In conclusion, though the British did bring railroads, reforms, and new thought to India, they also negatively affected Indian society and the poorer populations. Thank you all for joining us today and helping us discover more of each side of this story. As far as history is concerned, there's no correct answer, so this debate will continue.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Sir Syed Ahmed Khan, and I'm here to introduce you to the two prominent nations that live in India, distinguished by the name of Hindus and Muslims. Now, just as a man has some principal organs, Hindus and Muslims are the two principal limbs of India. To be a Hindu or a Muslim is a matter of personal faith and has nothing to do with the external conditions or the mutual relationship. Now, how good is the saying, whoever may be its author, that a man is composed of two principal elements? One is the faith that he owes to God, and the second is the moral sympathy that he owes to each other. Now, leave God's part to God and focus on what's ours. Ladies and gentlemen, just as many individuals professing the Hindu faith have come before us, we too migrated to this country. The Hindus have forgotten their land of migration and come to believe that their homeland is between the Vidyanchal and the Himalayas. We too migrated centuries ago. We've forgotten the deliciousness of our fruit, our harvest, our land, our water. We've come to believe that the water of the Ganga and the Yamuna is our own holy water, that India is our homeland. We live and we die together.
Gandhi is born in 1869. Gandhi learned much from his family. His father never lost his temper. Gandhi learned it was better to tell the truth, even when making a mistake. His mother taught him that fasting and praying were ways to achieve control over oneself and equally over others.
Dear father, I have lied to you. I have stolen a bit of gold out of my brother's armlet and sold it. The secret is more than I can bear. I resolve never to steal again. I am confessing to you, father. Since I dare not speak, I am writing it. I know you will never reach me. I am only afraid of the pain this will cause you. Please do not punish yourself for my offense. I will never steal or lie again.
Father, do you forgive me?
Never lie to me again.
Mughal Dad, if the Thali is ready in the kitchen, please wash your hands and eat properly. Oh, fasting is normal. I've done it many times before.
Mohandas, Jawaharlal, and Mohammed Ali, known to you as Gandhi, Nehru, and Jinnah, all went to London to study. They learned many things. Nehru, born in 1889, went to Harrow Public School and later to Cambridge. Initially, Nehru was painfully shy. He felt like an outsider and knew that his classmates considered him as well. He tried to overcome his awkwardness, but remained a lone figure.
Thank you. Thank you for joining us at today's awards ceremony. We're here to recognize a very special student for his academic excellence. Jawaharlal, for your success here at Nehru, we'd like to present you with this book by your role.
More schools for girls, and for those who admitted those from the untouchable past.
This led to my establishment of the Society of Truth Seekers, whose members vowed to basic tenets such as throwing off alcohol, but also to larger tenets, such as promoting education for women and those of low castes. In the 1860s, my interest widened from education to social reform. And under my direction, the society lobbied the government to promote policies that would benefit farmers and laborers, especially those considered bourgeois. My book, The Cultivator's Whipcord, discusses the troubles of a peasant farmer, analyzes its context, and offers an agrarian reform. If the words that I wrote are not read, then the government shall remain the same, and the peasants' community will always remain the same.
The Viceroy of India, Lord Curzon, decided that...
Kolkata is a city from which the Congress Party is manipulating the whole of Bengal. And indeed the whole of India. The whole of their activities is directed at creating an agency so powerful that they may one day be able to force a weak government to give them what they desire. In consequence, any measure that would divide the Bengali-speaking population, that would dethrone Calcutta from its place as a center of successful intrigue, is needed.
Suddenly, the people of India and Bengal knew a lot of unity in the name of nationalism and India.
Hey, friends, how are you? Good. Every Indian has got a love. So good.
Hi, how are you? Bande! Mataram! Bande! Mataram! Bande! Mataram!
Forever separate.
misunderstood. In the north, I find the division of the Hindu-Muslim problem. In the south, in the very shadows of temples where, for centuries, the prayers of men have gone forth for bringing about unity for all classes, I find a division again. Not between people of different race or creed, but between blood brothers, between the children of one mother, followers of one creed and sharers of one destiny, whose marriages and funerals take place on the same street. I find this bitterness between classes to be the worst of all these bitternesses. What is a frontier attack compared to this division? What is the battle between the Hun and the Saxon compared to the civil war in our streets? It is for you to stand up today and say, we are tired of these divisions. We are tired of these things that have made us slaves in the hands of a foreign government. From today, we consecrate our lives only to our national regeneration.
Mohandas Gandhi emerged as an even larger leader in the 1950s. While he sat spinning in his ashram, he instructed people on naturopathy, satyagraha, and non-violence. He led them on many rounds of non-violent non-cooperation with the British Raj. Then he led them on a long march to the sea, where he went to break one of the most oppressive British laws. He went to make salt, a symbolic gesture to defy the British.
This is Vince Walker of the New York Times. Today, Mr. Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, a feeble, old, unarmed man, put the British Empire to shame by calling for a complete stoppage of work across India through nonviolent, non-resistance. Mr. Gandhi and his followers were able to show up the hollow power of the British Empire. Non-violent followers have suffered violent attacks at the hands of the British authorities, and yet they still completed their 200-mile walk to Gandhi Beach on the Indian Ocean to manufacture salt. Once again, Mr. Gandhi and his followers appear to have exposed the weakness of the empire.
Soldiers of India's Army for Liberation. Today is the proudest day of my life. Today, it has pleased Providence to give me the unique privilege and honor of announcing to the whole world that India's Army of Liberation has come into being. There are people who thought at one time that the empire on which the sun is not set is an everlasting empire. No such ever thought troubled me. History had taught me that every empire has its inevitable decline and then collapse. Comrades, I have said that today is the proudest day of my life, but this honor carries with it a corresponding responsibility. For the present, I can offer you nothing except hunger, thirst, privation, forced marches, and death. But if you follow me in life and death, I shall lead you to victory and freedom. It does not matter who among us will live to see India free. It is enough that India shall be free. May God grant us victory in our coming fight.
Yes, the nation did grow stronger, but it also started splitting into two. And the following issues must be considered.
Is Hindu-Muslim unity necessary for India's political advancement? If necessary, is it still possible, despite the new ideology, that Hindus and Muslims are two distinct nations?
I am Maulana Azad. I'm a Muslim and I am proud of that fact. Islam's splendid tradition of 1300 years are my inheritance. I'm unwilling to lose even the smallest part of this inheritance. The teaching and history of Islam, its arts and letters, and its civilization are my wealth and my fortune. It is my duty to protect them.
I'm Mohammed Ali Jinnah. I think it's extremely difficult to appreciate why our Hindu fans fail to understand the real nature of Hinduism and Islam. They're not religions, but are social orders. It is a dream that Hindus and Muslims can ever evolve together. And the misconception is the reason for destruction.
Mother India, if she remained one integral whole, can rely upon both Hindus and Muslims to defend her independence, assuming it is fought for from the British.
It was India's history.
historic destiny that many human races, cultures, and religions should flow to her, finding a home in her fertile soil. This vast land gave welcome to all and took them to her bosom. One of the last of these caravans was that of the followers of Islam. This fusion was a notable event in history. Full 11 centuries have passed since then. Islam has now as great a claim to the soil of India as Hinduism.
Hindus and Muslims belong to two different cultures, religious philosophies, and customs. They neither intermarry nor interdine. They belong to two conflicting ideas and conceptions.
Having regard to the prevailing antagonism between the Hindus and the Muslims, and the new ideology of two distinct nations, can a single constitution for these two nations be built in the hope that they will work at it and not against it?
This 1,000 years of our joint life has molded us into a common nationality. This cannot be done artificially. I shall not take any more of your time. Please permit me to remind you that our success depends on three factors: unity, discipline, and full confidence in Mahatma Gandhi's leadership.
I am fine. Abdul Ghaffar Khan. Out of love, people call me Badshah Khan. I have never thought of Indian Muslims as a separate political religious community. Communal violence and a constitutional arrangement that serves as a solution for this violence needs to be separated. Communal violence is just another kind of violence. It's a disease that saps our human spirit. The people fighting each other are just using religion as its justification. What can we do about this problem? Constitutional arrangements by itself will not guarantee communal peace. A transformation of the moral fiber of society is required. Talks about separate electorates or provincial balances is for another time, a different discussion. India is for both Hindus and Muslims, living together in peace.
To yoke together two such nations under a single state, one as a minority and the other as a majority, is the cause of our discontent in the state.
If India cannot be one united country, is it not better that Indians should help India in the peaceful dissolution of this whole incoherent mess into its natural parts, namely Pakistan and Hindustan?
On August 15, 1947, two new states will be formed, India and Pakistan. All those in favor, please raise your hand.
We are in favor, yes.
Nehru, yes.
Molana Azad, yes.
Muhammad Ali Jinnah, yes.
Sayyid Ahmed Khan, yes.
Badshah Khan, no.
Years ago, we had a tryst with destiny, and now the time comes when we must redeem our pledge, not wholly or in full, but very substantially. At the stroke of the midnight hour, as the world sleeps, India will awake to life and freedom.
I cordially thank you, with the utmost sincerity, for the honor you have conferred upon me. The greatest honor that is possible for the Sovereign Assembly to confer by electing me as your first president. I sincerely hope that with your support and your cooperation, we will make this Constituent Assembly an example to the world.
A moment comes, which comes but rarely, when we must step from the old to the new, when an age ends and the soul of a nation, long suppressed, finds utterance.
I know there are people who do not quite agree with the division of India and the partition of Punjab and Bengal. Much has been said against it, but now that it has been accepted, it is the duty of every one of us to loyally abide by it and honorably act according to the agreement, which is now final and binding on all.
It is fitting at this solemn moment we take the pledge of dedication to the people of India and to the still larger cause of humanity.
A division had to take place on both sides, in Hindustan and Pakistan. There are sections of people who may not agree with it, but you are free. You are free to go to your temples. You are free to go to your mosques or to any other place of worship in the state of Pakistan. My guiding principle will be justice and complete impartiality. And I am sure that with your support and cooperation, I can look forward to Pakistan becoming one of the greatest nations of the world.
We, the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign, secular, democratic republic, and to secure to all its citizens justice, social, economic, and political, liberty, thought, expression, belief, equality of status and opportunity, fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual. In our Constituent Assembly, this 26th day of November 1949, do hereby adopt, enact, and give to ourselves this Constitution.
Political power in this country has too long been in the hands of the few, and the many are not only beasts of the burden, but also beasts of the prey. These downtrodden classes are tired of being governed. Independence is no doubt a matter of joy, but let us not forget that this independence has thrown on us a great responsibility. We have lost the excuse of blaming the British for anything that goes wrong. If hereafter, any mistake we make, any fault we take, is on us.
Gaurav Saini is a theatre artist from India. He directs, teaches, and performs. One of his main areas of interest is working with children, especially adapting and directing classical plays. With adults, both actors and non-actors, he conducts workshops and courses of different kinds, from professional acting training to courses which bridge the academic and performative mediums, such as undergraduate students. He is a visiting Mellon Scholar at the Claremont Colleges. He was invited by Professor Nita Kumar, their theatre facilitator, in her course, The Makers of Modern People. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving him a round of applause.
So here is the cast before you, and the director is also present in the audience. Please raise your hand and ask the question.
Built it part by part, so some of the scenes that we made can help you remember, but I guess it's easier to understand them better. I'll have it there.
I think it did help. Some of us learned by acting it out, some of us learned by reading, some of us are excellent talkers and good paper writers. That leaves me out. We had fun doing the acting as well.
So, like, in that process. So I think it gave like a very view from both sides. So I think I can understand the creation of Pakistan from the Pakistani point of view much better. So I think that's what the creation
of
Pakistan.
Well,
enough of
what Natasha said earlier. I completely agree that like, when I was growing up with Gandhi, like, he was very like hero-sized, and I was just like, oh, he's this amazing person. But I think in this class, I feel like he is just another person who like has some really great ideas and he has some great like, leadership skills, but he was another person who's trying to save his country.
Also, another side of it, if you look at Nehru and Jinnah, you tend to think of them speaking for different religions. So once you realize they're right over at Jinnah, it's only that religions pick up for their personal political ideals, what they want to achieve, or how that comes true. Like it's not true that they spoke totally for their population, or they necessarily didn't live totally in it, but then their personality, I think, produced a lot to learn more about their personality and how they're improving the population.
Yeah, and going off of that, just learning about their, from their childhood, through their deaths, like if they're through autobiography or secondhand sources, and they just made the figures a lot more
And also, I feel like when you study like the, in this period, a lot of figures are often like I wrote my mission paper on Molana Azad, which is why I was here, and I hadn't heard of him until this class. And I realized it was a very important part of the
mission. I think one misconception we also have, I don't know if it's a misconception, but it's my misconception, but we have this idea that India was created on the basis of complete non-violence. But I think what I've understood in this class is that before we had people like Gandhi, we did have people like Balgama, I did not have a very deep understanding of that. There were people who actually put down their foot for independence, after which we gave a platform to people like Gandhi. So just again going off their points that it wasn't a single random a multitude of people using a multitude of words together.
My biggest takeaway from this class, studying all these personalities, was like, wow, British India had a great Indian civil society. We had politicians who actually gave a shit. God knows why that happened. What happened to that after independence? Like, if you hear any of what the politicians refer to freedom fighters today, India is nowhere near their like, idea of what it should be.
No, absolutely. Do you think British, or like Britain, towards India, I don't know, they have
yeah.
Is that something which is?
Yes.
Shashi Tharoor.
Yes.
Shashi Tharoor. Shashi Tharoor.
Yes. I noticed your.
Yes.
Yeah, that's like the best one. Should that be reparation? No. I stand by his words.
Yeah.
I just believe reparations as a concept are not the way. Even when people ask for reparations for Black Americans in the United States, or for Latinos in the United States, or when they're asking for the British Union, it's just a form of telling the society that yes, the problem is over, that we've tackled the problem, whereas the problem still exists. So like, reparations are just like a scapegoat you use to actually get rid of the actual problem. So yes, in India, maybe reparations might work, because we're still not at the colonial rule. But then reparations as a concept, especially in the United States, I don't believe in the would still continue to be neglect the Black American saying that yes, we solved your problems by giving you a cup of something that's actually not getting rid of.